Senate Bill 1172 regulates a form of therapy that has no medical basis. It's been called reparative therapy, ex-gay therapy, homosexual conversion therapy. And what this purported therapy tries to do is to take someone who is homosexual and convert them to someone who is heterosexual. The medical community has come out in force saying there is no medical evidence for this, and that's because being a homosexual is not a mental condition, disorder, defect, or illness that requires any sort of cure. When you look at the DSM-IV manual, which psychiatrists and other folks look at in terms of medical conditions, sexual orientation is nowhere listed among that. Now, it's not surprising then that this therapy also doesn't work. There has been no reputable study that shows that this therapy in fact works. And in fact, the only study that showed it might have even some effect was done by a professor by the name of Dr. Robert Spitzer. Last month, he retracted that study and apologized to the gay and lesbian community because his study, he concluded, was wrong. So if this was just a case where people were wasting money on therapies that didn't work, I wouldn't be quite as passionate about this bill. But I'm passionate because not only does it not work, there is evidence that it could be dangerous. Folks have gone through this therapy, have experienced guilt, shame, depression, in extreme cases, suicide. And that is why this bill regulates an unregulated area. And what my bill will do is to ban reparative therapy for anyone under 18, and then for adults, require an informed consent. And with that, I have witnesses here in support and respect the request, and I vote.
Thank you. Witnesses in support.
Hello, my name is Peter Drake. I'm the executive director of the COIL Foundation in San Francisco. I am left-handed, and I am gay. I could learn to write with my other hand, but that is not who I am. And I would never be comfortable as a right-hander. And I did live in a straight marriage for 28 years. But eventually, I had to come to understand and accept my gay identity. And after nearly killing myself, I came out in 2009. I have had personal, painful experience with the harm that can be done by reparative therapy, or otherwise known as SOCE work. I spent nearly 3 years subjected to this therapy from 2001 into 2004. And it was extremely detrimental to my mental health. I was attempting to change my sexual orientation. My low-grade depression only worsened during the time of my treatment. There was no change in my sexual orientation. I became increasingly frustrated, shameful, angry, sad, and removed. The therapist's change efforts ranged from trying to get me more involved in sports, like a man, to reimagine myself lusting for the female anatomy. Most dangerously, he attempted to father me, providing a supposed transference to the dad I never had, who would hold my hand through to masculinity. There were undertones of spiritual weakness and the need for a more active prayer life to overcome my sin. The hopes I had that I could be cured of this malady were dashed, and my therapist offered no comfort, leaving me broken. Completely discouraged, I moved on to another therapist. Slowly, I came to accept myself as a gay man and was able to free myself to live an integrated, emotionally, spiritually, and physically alive life. With support from my wife, my straight marriage ended amicably. Recently, a more progressive pastor said to me, "Peter, I am glad you are ready to be the man God made you to be." These are the words I needed to hear so long ago, instead of being told that I was broken and that I could be fixed. I think that SOCE, reparative therapy, is a form of medical malpractice. Practitioners of this misguided therapy make claims about healing something that is not an illness, and they're not successful. Our sexual orientation is an important part of who we are made to be. My daughter came out as a lesbian. Thank God we avoided encouraging SOCE work for her. Fortunately, she did her own good therapy work and has emerged happy and balanced. Teenagers are so brutally damaged by this approach, and the consequences of SOCE with my daughter may well have been suicide. She is now a proud lesbian on her way to medical school and public health school this fall. Now, my committed partner, Philippe, who is here today, and I have started the Coming Out into Light, or COIL, Foundation to support those who need to be welcomed and loved as we are. I've attended many conferences, I've supported anti-SOCE symposiums, and I've heard many, many stories. In conclusion, I have never heard a happy ending story about reparative therapy SOCE work truly changing someone's sexual orientation. With this dangerous work, at best, people end up living their life uncomfortable in their own skin, discouraged, not supported for who they really are, as though I were to write with my right hand. Please support this important legislation to save lives and to promote the well-being of people like me and my daughter. Thank you.
Thank you, and thank you for sharing your story. Next.
Hello. Thank you, Madam Chair and members. Oh, sorry. Thank you. Thank you, Madam Chair and members. My name is Catherine Sakimura. I'm a staff attorney and director of the Family Protection Project at the National Center for Lesbian Rights. I'm in support of SB 1172. NCLR's youth project was founded in 1993 to address the mistreatment of LGBT youth in the mental health system. And our staff has seen firsthand the devastating mental and physical health impact of attempts to change a young person's sexual orientation. We've also seen the devastating impact on parents and families when they are misled by therapists into believing that therapy can change a person's sexual orientation. Because this therapy has no scientific basis and carries such high risks, many of the country's major medical and mental health associations have come out with policy statements about this therapy. For example, the American Academy of Pediatrics has advised youth to avoid treatments that claim to be able to change a person's sexual orientation or treatment ideas that see homosexuality as a sickness. This bill prohibits the use of sexual orientation change efforts on minors because they are uniquely vulnerable and because the risks are so great. This bill would not affect the ability of minors to seek other therapeutic treatments. It will only prohibit the use of sexual orientation change efforts on efforts to change a young person's sexual orientation. Thank you for your consideration, and we urge your support of SB 1172.
Thank you. Go ahead.
Thank you, Madam Chair and members. Alice Kessler on behalf of Equality California. We're the lead sponsor of the bill, and this is an issue that many members of the organization have contacted us about. One of the impetuses of the bill was learning that an organization called the North American Reparative Therapy Association was actually licensed as a continuing education provider in the state, and that caused some outcry in the LGBT community. We would like to thank Senator Lieu, our co-sponsors. I think Mr. Drake very eloquently stated the need for this bill. I think it's an idea whose time has come. And I did also want the committee to know that we have been having a very open stakeholder process with some of the organizations that have an oppose unless amended position, and we're committed to continuing those conversations with them. Thank you for considering your vote. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chair and members of the committee. My name is Nicole Scanlon. I'm with Mental Health America of Northern California, and we are the co-sponsor of this bill, and we urge you to vote aye. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Any other witnesses in support of the bill? Witnesses in opposition?
The chair wants.
Madam Chair and members, Tim Shannon representing the California Association of Marriage and Family Therapists. As your committee analysis notes, we're one of the stakeholder groups. Four stakeholder groups have written a letter of oppose unless amended on this bill. First of all, I want to thank the author for reaching out to us early. We had a stakeholder meeting before he introduced the legislation, and we are glad to hear that those conversations are going to continue. We understand what the author is trying to do. The problem for us with this bill is that the definition of SOCE is a little too broad, and it would encompass more than the things that the author, I believe, is rightly trying to address. Frankly, to hear the author's opening statement when he mentioned what reparative therapy was, he actually got a little closer to the mark than the bill does in the definition, because he talked about it as being therapy that's trying to fix something. And what we've said to the author all along is, if this bill were to say that it was unprofessional conduct to give therapy that's based on a premise that homosexuality is a disease or a pathology, we would support that. We all believe that that's unprofessional conduct. Unfortunately, the definition that's in the bill is too broad and would capture activity which could be affirmative and evidence-based. So we're hoping that in the conversations that continue as this bill moves forward, we're going to narrow that. We have not seen movement yet on that very critical issue. And if the bill is amended the way I described, which is to say it's unprofessional conduct to engage in therapy that is based on a premise that homosexuality is a disease or that you're fixing something, then the other issues that are in the bill go away, because you won't need an informed consent, because you're basically saying you can't do this. Thank you.
Madam Chair, Randall Hager for the California Psychiatric Association. We agree completely with Tim. We are part of the coalition that provided the letter to you. If I may just read into the record the American Psychiatric Association's policy statement. It is one sentence. It's not long. I think it makes things very, very clear. The American Psychiatric Association opposes any psychiatric treatment such as reparative or conversion therapy which is based upon the assumption that homosexuality per se is a mental disorder, or based upon a prior assumption, that the patient should change his or her homosexual orientation. So the California Psychiatric Association, even if it wanted to, could not deviate from our national policy, and we do not want to. We completely and fully subscribe to those statements. And so we think that that particular statement would form the basis for a good definition. As Tim has said, I think the definition does get a little more expansive in the bill. If we could go in that direction, I think we'd be all much more comfortable. Thank you.
Thank you.
Amanda Levy, representing the California Psychological Association, also signed on to the joint letter. And I just want to say we have appreciated working with the author, but today we have not reached agreement on the number of amendments that we have suggested with him. So just to piggyback on the other two professional associations, our association nationally, the profession has done more to advance and have a scientific research on LGBT issues, as evidenced by the quotes from the bill. So we are in support of the effort. The devil is in the details. We are very concerned about the definition of SOCE right now in the bill, and we believe it will preclude people from entering into therapeutic relationships with therapists who are not trying to perform SOCE in any way, shape, or form. It will stop just the conversation of somebody saying, I'm having some feelings, I'd like to talk to you about it, for fear of the cause of action that could be brought against them in the bill. So what we're trying to do is just look at the language right now in the bill. Also, we just want to point out there are professional ethics, the code of ethics for each profession, as well as licensing boards where these complaints can be brought today. And we hope that that's an avenue that could be pursued as well, because we believe much of what is being discussed is unprofessional conduct already, as homosexuality is not a mental disorder. It's not in the DSM, and we'd like to see those avenues pursued as well. So we're happy to continue working, but there still is much work to be done on the language of the bill itself.
Who would like to go next? Go ahead.
Now I'm on. Thank you, honorable committee members. My name is David Pickup. I'm a licensed marriage and family therapist in the state of California, an associate member of the APA, a member of CAMPT, and a member and representative of the National Association for the Research and Therapy of Homosexuality. NARTH, or otherwise known as NARTH, NARTH does not believe that homosexuality is a mental disorder. NARTH clinicians never, as a policy, coerce anyone in any kind of therapy, especially our beautiful young children, gay, straight, LGBT, or ex-gay. We don't coerce anyone. Also, I want to mention here, we're at NARTH, we're frankly a little taken aback. We have spent a lengthy meeting with the author of this bill, and written many letters from our organization, which is a highly scientifically based therapeutic organization. And we have not been put down as a stakeholder in this. It's not been publicized in the analysis, and we can't help but wonder why. NARTH is noted as a highly professional organization, one which promotes high standards of scientific research. Through lengthy analysis, NARTH has determined that any of the scientific studies cited in 1172, most notably the Ryan study, when viewed through the lens of the APA task force's high methodological standards, simply demonstrates how science appears to have been hijacked in service of concocting an authoritative-sounding link between SOCE, family rejection, and negative health outcomes. There are no scientific grounds for referencing the Ryan study as justification for a ban on SOCE to minors. The study's findings, while likely having some correct reflections, are not reliable and have no scientific justification for being generalized to all minors. It is troubling that 1172 would utilize the Ryan study when its limitations make such claims profoundly misguided, as underscored by the APA Task Force methodological studies and research guidelines itself. In addition, of all the mental health associations referenced by 1172, none have banned SOCE with minors. The unmistakable implication of this bill is that the California licensing agencies and mental health associations are so derelict in their protection of LGBT youth that politicians must step in and do their work for them. How else should we understand the complete absence of licensure revocations, membership suspensions, or any ethical complaints among licensed SOCE therapists if suicides and severe mental anguish are so presumably widespread among LGBT youth because of SOCE? Either these agencies and professional associations are incredibly negligent and inept, or 1172 is an ideological agenda masquerading as a legislative solution to a clinical problem that simply does not exist. And finally, there is no doubt in the minds of NARTH members, certainly not in mine as a representative of all these bodies, that 1172 would cause mental harm and anguish to a population that has yet to be discussed in any of the committee meetings so far. As a licensed therapist, I can tell you that every year a segment of California's young male population are raped or sexually molested by men or older boys. Every professional therapeutic organization knows, any therapist worth his salt knows, that homosexual feelings commonly occur in most of these victims as a result of these abuses. If passed, SB 1172 would make it against the law to help these boys and young men lessen or dissipate homosexual feelings, which do not represent for them
I need you to wrap up.
Their inborn traits. I ought to know about this, because I was one of those boys. So if this law passes, guys like me and guys like my clients can't get the help that they need. Why should we be marginalized for these issues and discriminated against? We urge you to abandon SB 1172.
Thank you. Next witness.
Right next. Good afternoon, honorable members of the committee. Matthew McReynolds here, staff attorney for Pacific Justice Institute. We sent a letter to the committee last week. We were a little surprised in reading the committee analysis and noting that none of the points that we raised were addressed in the analysis, specifically the significant constitutional issues that surely must come to the minds of some committee members when we start talking about banning an entire category of speech based on the content and the viewpoint of that speech. And further, when we talk about stepping into the counseling room or the doctor's office, in the case of the psychiatrist, and clamping a hand over the mouths of the clinicians when they begin to venture into this area of highly sensitive information with their clients. We're here to strongly oppose the bill for these reasons, because we don't see how it can possibly survive constitutional challenge, and to answer any questions that committee members may have. And would love to hear the author's the perspective on that. One other point I would like to make is there were significant what we believe to be perhaps unintended consequences from the bill, perhaps drafting or otherwise, the most alarming being the coupling of this new compelling state interest in protecting such a broad category of health risks with the notion of family rejection of gay and lesbian youth, which is without definition in the bill, and which seems to lead to the specter of youth being perhaps taken away from families that are not properly supportive in the way that this legislative body might deem them to be. If that is not the intent of the bill, then those provisions must be changed. We're here to register strong opposition, to urge the committee members to rethink a number of the provisions, and there are others mentioned in our letter as well.
Yes, we have your letter. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Next witness.
Here representing licensed professional clinical counselors. We're the fourth group to sign on to that joint letter with concerns over the definition portion of the bill. Look forward to working with the author's office to address those concerns.
Thank you. Next witness.
My name is Norm Rogers, and I'm not a professional like these other people, but I have worked with youth for about 40 years in various communities, diverse communities, mostly in Southern California. And I have known young people who've gone through sexual and gender reorientation therapy with great success. So to think that young people like that would no longer have the possibility to go through that process is disturbing to me. I think the author and the bill, they hit the target, but they miss the bull. It misses the bullseye, because we're all concerned about respect for all people. And, of course, we are all guaranteed that under the Constitution. I think that we, the people, with the legislature, need to promote respect and not additional regulatory burden for the state. That's my first point. The second point is that I believe that this bill will endanger parental rights, which are already kind of fragile, and they'll violate the constitutional rights of minors. Now, rights to life-defining issues are available to minors in the state, for example, in the family courts, down to approximately age 12. Thirdly, I think this bill is written with flawed and missing scientific evidence. Passage of this bill will put the state at significant risk for multiple future litigations. I don't believe that this bill promotes the best interests of any of the stakeholders. And I really believe that as a society, we can learn to respect each other without enacting more laws and then producing the need to enforce those laws. So I would urge you all and the legislature in its entirety to promote things which promote respect and not more regulatory burden for all of us.
Thank you. Next witness.
Yes. Jerry Harris, a licensed marriage and family counselor, a member of the American Psychological Association, American Association of Marriage and Family Therapists, and the California Association of Marriage and Family Therapists. I'm also the board member of NARTH, the National Association for Research and Therapy for Homosexuality. This bill paints a pretty dire picture of sexual orientation change efforts. And yet, as has been pointed out previously, so I won't go into it, yet there has been no actions that I could find out as of yesterday of any loss of licensure or probationary actions taken against anybody who has met with such individuals wanting to deal with their unwanted same-sex thoughts, feelings, or behaviors. Secondly, the bill presents a very one-sided picture of the research. There's ample evidence in peer-reviewed journals and anecdotally from the thousands of members of support groups and, quote, ex-gay members from such groups as Exodus, Jonah, Courage, Evergreen, etc., that people can and do change or diminish their same-sex thoughts, feelings, and and behaviors. And lastly, and that therapists, all the therapists that I know that are involved with clients presenting with unwanted same-sex thoughts, feelings, or behaviors, do not start with the assumption that homosexuality is a mental illness. It has not been a mental illness for decades, and it is not a mental illness now. But there is a concern because it's unwanted. And so the clients want to know how to deal with it, resolve it. How should they move forward? And that's what a therapist helps them to do. And sometimes that they may assist them in diminishing those same-sex thoughts, feelings, and behaviors. Thank you very much. And I think it's duplicating a lot of things that are done by the professional associations and the Board of Behavioral Sciences. Thank you.
Thank you. I just want to note the committee does not have a letter from NARTH. So if you had intended to submit a letter of opposition to the committee,
we did intend to. I thought it was there. We will do that.
Yeah. Appreciate that.
Thank you for mentioning that. I was told it was. We'll make sure that's done. Thank you.
Thank you
for asking about that. May I say one more thing?
No, sorry.
Okay.
we'll take a look at your letter. Thank you.
Okay.
Any other witnesses in opposition? All right, we'll bring this back to the committee. Comments, questions from the committee members? Mr. Leno?
I wanted to, thank you, Madam Chair, ask Senator Lieu if you could comment with regard to some of the oppositional statements, specifically the definition and the suggestion from a couple of folks. How is it you haven't reached agreement yet? Because it seems like there could be some easy resolution here from the very associations which would fall under the umbrella of the beautiful statement of the American Psychiatric Association.
I do not disagree with you. And we have taken several amendments. We will take more amendments, and we are having discussions on the actual definition. It certainly is not my intent to capture affirmative or evidence-based therapies within the definition. So I will be working very closely to try to remove the opposition.
Okay. And what is your response with regard to the First Amendment issue?
This is the practice of medicine. The fact that the practice of medicine also involves speech doesn't also make it protected under the First Amendment. Because under their view, basically a therapist could never get sued for malpractice ever because it's free speech. And that's really a ridiculous notion. And so this is really looking at it from the practice of medicine standpoint. And I don't believe their free speech issues are implicated because they are practicing medicine and they simply use speech as a way to do it.
Good to know. And if I may, Madam Chair, just to make a comment, I especially appreciate Mr. Drake's testimony today. I came out to my parents and family more than 40 years ago in 1969, which predates the American Psychiatric Association removal of homosexuality from its list of mental illnesses. And I have to say, historically, that was one of the most profound changes that occurred through the civil rights movement. If we especially date the beginning of it to the Stonewall riots in 1969. In fact, all of this could really benefit students if we actually taught it in their schools, which I know is about to be implemented. So when I did in 1969, I was suddenly in a psychiatrist's office at the strong suggestion of my parents. It was a mental illness at the time, and they didn't know any different or better. My blessing at the time was different from Mr. Drake's experience. And when I told the psychiatrist, when he asked, why am I here, I told him I was very concerned that I might be homosexual. His response was, and why do you think that's problematic? And so, as I say, that was my blessing at the time. And in the ensuing years, my parents learned much more, as did I, and that was the coming out process. And it's been a wonderful and beautiful life ever since. But there are many who are trapped in this horror situation that Mr. Drake very articulately expressed. And it can have extraordinarily negative impacts. And so I'm happy, very happy to support the bill today, Senator Lieu, and I know that you will continue to work with many of the oppositional voices who are our strongest allies over these past decades.
Correct.
And I'm pleased to move the bill.
All right, we have a motion. Would you like to close?
Yes. So first of all, we have reached out to NARTH. We also did not get a letter. Look, NARTH is never going to come out and say, hey, we're engaging in the unauthorized practice of medicine. I mean, they're not going to say that. They're not going to say, look, the American Psychiatric Association says we oppose repair therapy and we're going to do it anyways. You're not going to hear it from them. What you'll hear is sort of the testimony today. But if you really listen to what the witness said, they do view this as a condition that needs to be fixed, that somehow people have this deep-seated trauma. If you could uncover that trauma and help them with it, they'll go from being homosexual to being heterosexual. And so it is exactly their practice that this bill does intend to target. And with that, respect request, and I vote.
All right. We have a motion, then we will call the roll with the author's commitment that he will continue working on the legislation.
The motion is due pass to the Senate floor. Evans?
Aye.
Evans, aye. Harmon?
No.
Harmon, no. Blakeslee? Corbett?
Aye.
Corbett, aye. Leno?
Aye.
Leno, aye.
All right, the vote is 3-1. The bill will remain on call to allow the absent member to vote.